the series, and you use it as a trap card, as a bait, because you know that PvP, if given the opportunity, would snap pick that.
Yeah, have to. Again, with Melly being really the heartbeat of this team, makes sense to target him out there. Hecarim and Taric complete the bans there on the PvP side, and Akali and Sylas there on the Vega side.
It is one of the concerns for Vega. We were peeking into their champion pools. They don't play Sylas, so they haven't shown it yet, especially not in a flex position. So it is, again, kind of one of those really scary things. Maybe that's why they're hesitant to go to blue side. They don't want to have to ban those champions from the blue side as well as the red side.
Well, heard about flexes already, but there's Jace first pick. Good champion for both Xeros and Gnoll, and with the kind of player that Xeros is, very aggressive, wants to dominate lane with help from his jungler. Makes sense there to pick that one up, and I like this from Vega, taking the Galio.
Yeah, I love that Santos is given a high-impact champion, especially one that can start impacting high into that river, and especially in tandem with likes of Rek'Sai. Everyone always talks about the cannonball composition, the Jarvan Galio, but I feel like Galio Rek'Sai gives you so much control over bottom side river, and just to echo Spawn, he feels like that's going to be the primary battleground right there. These teams love to fight around bottom, at least in their previous best of fives, and if you have something like a Galio and Rek'Sai, you should get the first punch when the fight breaks out there.
So Nautilus and actually Kai'Sa there for PvP, so I believe that's the first Nautilus appearance for Fongfu Buffalo this tournament. Curious to see where that goes, but I would guess Gnoll, and is answered in kind here by Vega with Aurelia, who was left open. So far, so standard for both these teams.
Yeah, and I'm actually really interested in why PvP decided to reveal both their solo lanes, because I agree. I think that it is Gnoll taking the Nautilus, and Xeros has been the Jace player for this team, so you expect that to go into the top lane, unless there's a wrench that they throw into everything, and maybe that is Palette taking the Nautilus down bottom. But, you know, revealing your solo lanes this early, you either just have faith that you can mechanically 1v1 or just muscle through most matchups, or you're just deciding that maybe it's a weird pick for support. I mean, winning bot lane has been very important.
We'll see, but Vega are at least respecting the possibility of Nautilus going somewhere else, because that's a Ryze ban to start off phase two of this draft. PvP ticking down. I'll go with Syndra, taking a champion away from Nomads.
That does feel like then that it's Palette on the Nautilus. I mean, Nautilus doesn't really care about a Syndra matchup. Go ahead, press R on me, see what happens. I'm not going to die.
We'll see what the final ban here is for Vega. And certainly the last section of this champ select is going to be the interesting half. I mean, Vega, we saw, I think, one standard game from their games throughout play-ins, so they're capable of playing standard. It's just not been their best look in all the games we've seen.
It feels like people are kind of jumping the gun right now and just being like, Vega, don't play standard ever again. No one wants to see it. Because when they did play it domestically and when they did play it in play-ins, it looked fine. You know, it's one thing to play standard against, you know, emerging region teams. It's a whole nother animal to play standard against the likes of Betty. So I think maybe you just leave the Flash Wolves taking our lessons away from that best of five. Maybe she'll give Gadget some credence that if he locks in a traditional ADC, like, give him another chance. Let him try to prove that he could still do this.
Well, there's LeBlanc and Nico banned away to finish off all 10 bans here in this. So no Nico this time for Gadget. Maybe expecting something like a Varus. We've seen a decent amount of that so far this tournament. Will be Zoe, though, taking it away from Gnoll again, giving him a lot of credit for this Nautilus flex.
But still also then hiding the fact that Gadget hasn't locked in his champion, so there is still a possibility that it is something weird, something a bit more abstract, or maybe one of his traditional mages that he likes to take down there. Although Nomans is typically their Zoe player.
See what PvP do to finish off this draft, and we'll get an idea of where Gnoll is in fact going. Yeah, there's Olaf locked in for PvP. So Meliodas going to take that one into battle.
So really wants to contest. The top side of the map for PvP between an Olaf and a Jace is absolutely disgusting. So Vega Squadron, it seems like the blueprint has been laid out for PvP. This is going to be about the top side of the map, the ability to snowball there. So just start grabbing your resources. Maybe grab something that can contest for the wave, like a Varus, and try to take control of the bottom.
Well, Orianna the last pick, and that is actually the first Olaf for this MSI. So Meliodas mixing it up. Probably didn't want Lee Sin versus something like the Rek'Sai, but also revealing that that is very likely Nautilus there in support, because that Orianna last pick for Gnoll seems pretty likely. Last pick, of course, is Chimer, so they leave it all the way to the end there for Gadget.
So it's not the standard ADC. I called for the Varus, but it is a very similar champion of what his job's going to be for the lane, which is to find that push priority. Now, the thing about Gadget's Chimer is that we had some questions. Was he just using this to deny it away from Xeros when we previously saw it against Detonation Focus Me, or was he a Chimer master? And the amount of skill shots that he was able to block with pulling up towers, his 3,000 IQ play of placing the turrets and then using the blast Gas Cone over the wall into the Dragon Pit. This guy is a Heimer master.
Yeah, it certainly wasn't his like one of first five Heimer games. Just seeing what happened there, no. Certainly
first time Heimer,
knows his way around the champion. But I mean, Vega kind of made us kept us guessing there towards the end. You know, thought maybe, okay, you know, it will be something like a Varus or a different marksman there for Gadget. Instead, they do get the Heimer. It falls all the way to last pick.
And what's cool here is that because Santas is so key to their playmaking ability, the fact that it is something like a Heimer who can be left on his own and be very self-sufficient, even when he's pushed forward in a lane, just unlocks Santas to use his experience on the stage and try helping out a Nanastic in that jungle. So this is what I want from Vega Squadron. I want Santas on the map, I want him on heavy playmakers, and I want to try to see Vega Squadron control that bottom side vision and try to exploit leverages there. Hopefully they get a good dragon spawn and they can look for a snowball.
On the other side, of course, for PvP, they picked standard, but that's been pretty much their whole idea since dominating the VCS throughout this year. Yes, again, they are a pretty high octane, pretty fast-paced team as the champions of the VCS, but they do play pretty stock standard. So this comp's something they've run a number of times, or at least things like it. I'm expecting Melee to go towards that top side because I feel like Jace versus Aurelia is one of those matchups where if someone dies early, things can fall over very swiftly.
Feels like the word that we use is volatile. It can be a very volatile matchup. Although the last time we've seen Melee kind of pathing around, you know, he doesn't always have to go towards Zeros' lane. Sometimes he does try to protect his weak side. And one of the nice things about this draft from PvP is he has so many tools and so many options in both his side lanes to set up ganks for him. The kill pressure that Jace is going to be available to provide, as well as the hard CC that Palette will bring with that Nautilus.
Yeah, one of those things about Nautilus is the ease of execution feels real nice, but especially if you're trying to pin someone down like Gadget and his Heimer. First turret, we'll get an Arcane Comet proc, but a bit of extra gold there for Palette as he takes that one out. And actually will invade kind of late here, but just, I think, getting info and unfortunately loses 100 health or so for it.
Give me the supportal combat. I'm ready for Santas and Palette to just go toe-to-toe. Unfortunately, both of them had a bit of a rough best of five yesterday. Palette was not connecting with the skill shot. Should be a little bit easier today on the Nautilus.
More turrets down again. A bit more gold, but more Arcane Comet procs. So looks like Ananasik will get some help. On the other side here, the Xeris and Meliodas with that early lens actually going to sweep in and try and start for this red buff invade. So we talked about the map being split based on the champions picks. Now the map's really going to get split.
Yeah, we assume that this is going to be about vertical jungling. So I'm going to pull up the mini map right here and then just everyone should be used to this. But right now, this side of the map, this is going to belong to PvP because they have access to the red buff. And there's no reason that Rek'Sai wants to cut across. Now, we'll keep our eyes and see if maybe they do something bizarre. But what it means is we said this was about topside. We said this is about unlocking Jace, allowing him to make the most of that volatile matchup. Now that there's no reason for Ananasik to go top because he doesn't have any camps to farm, it just is free farm for Xeros up there. He can be as explosive and abusive as he wants to in that top matchup.
You can see Crab here on the right going to go down over to Rek'Sai.
He's going to try to three buff him.
Yeah, Meliodas actually pathing down back towards his own Raptors here, so already took the red buff and the Raptor camp away from the Vega jungle and is actually going to get away with his cross maps through mid lane. And Ananasik's just forcing himself back to the blue side jungle.
And that's the key thing, and it's because of the wave pressure that Big Coral and Palette have.
Oh my god, Heimer!
Trading back a lot.
Lasers. I thought the hook was good from Palette, but loses the trade in epic fashion.
Okay, so it was really good until that moment. Palette's gonna hopefully walk it off, but losing your flash will certainly hurt. But it's just like you're saying, the fact that Olaf went cross map across mid lane.
They're going for it. Stun land in. Arcane come up. Prox. Palette looks to be on the menu.
Oh!
First blood, but Big Coro finds the explosion, takes down the support, and that's first blood PvP.
It felt like both teams didn't really know how much damage they're going to do. I'm looking at Palette. I'm like, I don't know if you want that one, but they didn't have the cooldowns to follow it up. But hold that. Ananasik now looking mid.
Yep. Null, maybe the target here. Does get the knock up there. He's going to force the flash. Very respectful there from Orianna.
Okay. So we're still going.
Yeah,
we're
Meliodas
not going to have some
here.
Time.
Olaf's going to fall asleep, and I think that will call off the end of the play.
Oh, boy. He's chasing him.
So you asked for support or combat, Froskaroon. You have gotten it. Maybe not as early as you called for.
I was so interested into how these jungle matchups were going to go over. This is so bold from Ananasik. You should not have access to the scrub camp. And Xeros is like, what are you doing? You can't walk up here. I have the rotation. Speaking of rotations.
Here comes Palette. No Man's ready with a flash. Puts him to sleep with that hook. Massive land there. The ignite down onto Null. No Man's trying to hold onto that flash, but I'm not sure if he's holding on for it to too long. Does flash out from under the ball. Gets out safely, but a nice roam from Palette.
Everything's on fire. That's how this game is going to be I was like, what kind of best five we're gonna get? Maybe if it's PvP, maybe it's very fast, it's very furious, maybe if it's Vega Squadron, it'll be a little bit slower, a little bit controlled, but everything is going for, you know, on fire, hardcore plays. We're looking to trade kills.
And again, Santa just didn't have any health. I think you thought as soon as that grenade landed, that was a kill for Heimer, but he didn't have any turrets in the area. That was all the laser damage that won them the earlier trade. Gadget just must not have had it on cooldown, because that, to me, I agree with you. That looked like a moment where Vega should have gotten first blood.
And anytime you have a champion like Heimer injected into these 2v2s, you're really going to test how well people know the trade patterns of these types of champions. And frankly, it looked like neither side, except for Gadget, really understood what his full capability was, because Santos goes in, he doesn't need to look for the trade back right there. Palette was curious how much damage he was going to absorb, but at the end of the day, Big Koro and Palette, Kai'Sa, Nautilus, probably a bit more standard, figure it out in the end.
All right, well, as we take stock of what's happened in the first 5 minutes of play, CS is pretty even across the board, but that first kill will give PVB a gold lead of about 1,000. Meliodas supporting his friends down here in the 2v2 is just going to sweep out the vision and make sure nothing else happens, but much faster than we might have expected here. We kind of think about how these two teams made it to this spot, playing in their group stages. Group A felt like the much faster one, Group B not so much, but it's breakneck pace to kick off the series. Azeros may be in some trouble.
I think this would be a little bit ambitious, just because Zeros has access to his flash. Maybe if he uses his knockaway right here.
Gonna hold on to it for now. Zeros trying to win the trade, but Boss just stands his ground and auto-attacks him. And Zeros being out of mana likely has to TP back here. And there's the Rek'Sai lying in wait, pops the Precy, gonna cancel the recall. Now what do you do, Zeros?
Now you pray.
I mean, wave's coming in, there's no jungler, no TP's up for your team. Nanasik, they're gonna let him go. I guess just can't see anything, so it's worried the jungler's already here.
I guess you just walk that one out. And that's what you're saying, Pastry. It's the fact that he doesn't know where Olaf is. Meanwhile, Meliodas is finally going to show an award, so you bet Nanasik is kicking himself now having vision of where the Olaf is and saying, oh, that was my kill. I could have expended the flash, or I could have expended the kill or the reach for that.
And instead, Zeros comes back up, TP's back with his tier 2 boots, and Boss will do the same, although currently he's going to hold onto that TP. The only prize for a Nanasik is that Wolf Camp that'll take away, but Olaf already putting a control ward down into Vega Squadron's blue jungle and going to take down this Grump.
So we started out with a strong side of the map, Medic. Thank you for explaining that to the viewers in Countdown. For top side for PvB, but now as Meliodas has kind of turned everything on its head and he's trying to abuse the lack of summoner spells for Santas in the bot lane and abuse the pushing power and kill pressure that Big Koro and Palette had down bottom, he's starting to blitz into that jungle and carve away all of this CS. You can see the disparity is opening up between the junglers. 44 to 31 right now, that's actually a big deal this early on in the game.
You can also see that Meliodas, despite the loss versus Team Liquid, still some pretty decent stats. I called him earlier the heartbeat of this team. He really is there when almost anything happens. I think has like 75% KP over the course of the tournament, and you can see 70 in that last series.
I mean, if he's not the heartbeat, he's certainly the spark. He's where everything really starts and turns into a full flame for this team.
Well, also some coverage being provided here by PVB for Zeros, but it's Palette instead that's found his way up into the top side of the map, going for a bit of a roam. Blue buff also going to be attempted steal here for PVB. Looks like they'll get away with it too. Smite though, forced by Meliodas.
And it's how they're playing with information. So the fact that they were able to do that despite not having access to Palette behind them, since he did look top, you can see that Vega Squadron are, you know, we don't know exactly where everyone is. Let's play this one cautiously. Our jungler's in base right now, so it's not worth like a hard contest. But you have to think, if they knew Palette was top lane, if he had showed, maybe that's a very different setup.
Right now, Zeros just going to clear out the rest of these minions. Boss actually going to, no, not go back, cancels that recall as Palette hooks back onto a wall to find himself next to his lame mate and get a bit of gold there, proccing the Targon stack. Also spy a Bilgewater Cutlass in the inventory for Big Koro. So we've seen a lot of Stormraiser first on Kai'Sa, but this is kind of a departure from that, likely looking for Blade of the Ruined King first here.
I also think it helps that when you're dealing with that type of poke, that Gadget just placed onto Kai'Sa with the rockets, that it helps to have the life steal and the sustain in the lane phase. So he can sit back here, just try to farm up on these creeps as the waves are constantly crashing into him.
Another good hook there for Palette. Gadget though does have the ulti ready. Big Koro charging in with a killer instinct. Flashes forward, grabs the kill, and now it's Santas that's in trouble. Palette hits six, he pops the depth charge, and Santas, it's goodbye and a double kill for the biggest of Koros.
The immediate burst damage that came out there, the fact that Big Koro didn't hesitate, pulled the trigger, and pushed down this Heimerdinger.
And again, we talked about Gadget his different picks. Heimer looked very strong when they played in play-ins, but Big Coral and Pallet showing know what they can get done. And of course, Gadget certainly had a struggle versus the Flash Wolves, but hold that thought as the Nanasig is ganking top. Flash on Burrow there, knock up is gonna land, and now the stun falls in. Q is easy stop, and here's Meliodas gonna try and get a counter kill. 1v2, pops the ulti there on the Olaf, and Boss just gonna run away to a minion. Now has to be careful about getting dove himself.
No flash available for Ananasic, so it would be a little bit harder to execute, but we'll see if Meliodas just walks up.
Chilling Smite, forcing the flash, there's the ulti out. Meliodas looking to get go down, and there's Boss finds the second kill.
Just frankly greed for Meliodas right now. There's no reason, just apart from the tower, he wanted the EXP, he wanted to see if maybe he could get a couple of pot shots with a fadeaway axe, but in the end, it smashes him. Now 2-0 on this Aurelia.
So again, a matchup where we thought Seras was at least looking good in those trades. Boss springboarded up in that 1v1 as he picks up the team out and walks himself back towards the lane.
And again, I kind of want to focus in as things are settling on the top side of map back to this bot side. Something that's really cool about how this Nautilus is going to interact with the Heimerdinger is now that Heimer has completed his lost chapter, although I may have told it, it's Santus looking for a gank, has flash.
Null the target, no cleanse up, but does have the flash as you mentioned, so just fine there.
Yeah, trying to find that window. Is that if Heimer is going to be so far forward down the lane, has the mana to sustain that so he can be constantly pushed, with a Nautilus ultimate, it makes it so devastating to be on that long of the lane because you have immediate hard CC. Is taking another look at this one here.
I mean, they tried something, but the CC was there. Easy follow up, and then just a quick Q there from Boss to finish it off. This is what you're mentioning, though. Greed here from Meliodas.
Yeah, and you know, maybe he gets a hold of Boss. He's able to turn that one around. Now mid.
Lots of no man's forced to flash away, but there's the follow. Killer Instinct again from Big Koro, although it's Null that gets the credit.
Big Koro is unlocked and ready.
Yeah, this bot lane, we talked about maybe in the 2v2 they can find some traction. Well, they did that, and now they're moving that advantage over the map. Again, Nautilus, the champion that we maybe expected to rise in priority. Support, you don't get as much damage, but the CC is still certainly there.
But this is what we wanted from Santas, who has the, you know, superior roam support with the Galio versus the Nautilus. He wanted him unlocked from his lane, assisting with dives like that. But unfortunately, just hasn't found the same traction that Pallet has.
Decent block there using the turret. Now a TP coming in from Vega. Pallet gonna be the target, ignited by Santas, his boss. The big strong member is gonna try and get himself a gear. Nautilus, close but not there. Gadget though finds the missiles. Now a 2v3, make it 4v3 as arrested PvP have made their way down. Santas channeling the W to try and buy some time. There's the Vanguard dead from boss, but it won't delay the death of Gadget. Now the dive coming out. Not gonna follow just yet, but have to be careful here for Aurelia.
But again, Big Koro picking up more of these kills. Now 4-0 on the Kai'Sa, has the completed Blade of the Rune King, probably going for a two-item power spike as we normally see on Kai'Sa's. Just a bit of a different order here, and picking up more plates. So this is right on track for PvP to start running away with this game.
Yeah, plates go over as Xeros and Big Koro collect some of that gold. Boss will stay for the wave because Gadget decided he's had enough of that Nautilus. He's gonna move from the bot lane in towards the top. Rift Herald also channeled, Nanasig did at least get that when all the bot action was happening.
I'm just curious, you know, normally when you make a play like this and you give so many plates over to a champion, it is something like a Kai'Sa, maybe one of your top laners, an Aurelia or a Jace, like that feels so impactful. On the likes of Heimer, I don't know the champion intimately well enough to decide if that's a good call. Like, we just gave Gadget all of this gold, he's already far behind. It feels like he has a lot of not utility, but like frustration built into his kit that he doesn't necessarily need to be that nuke, but we'll now pay attention to Gadget. His team prioritized him there with the Rift Herald call, and he better start hitting really hard to get him back in the game.
Yeah, Boss also in trouble, currently in a bit of a situation, although Pallet now has found the friends of Vega roaming down, but everyone here together as Fongvu Buffalo trying to find a kill, won't grab it, but will at least try and pressure for a second turret. Oh, they're first, actually.
Yeah, just trying to get some control over this area. Unfortunately, with no dragon spawn, I think PvP are investing a bit too heavily down bottom because Vega, in the last 3 minutes, have actually made better map rotations, I feel. Yep. Not necessarily winning in the skirmishes, but taking down top tower and getting a good chunk out of mid.
Certainly one of the things that Heimer is good at, as he does drop the ulti turret to get a decent chunk of damage onto the turret and collect himself yet another plate. So despite being down about 20 CS or so, does have a large influx of gold, and Illudens now completed there for the Heimer.
It's just kind of one of those things where, you know, if you see Illudens come out on a champion who is struggling to find the wave clear, you say like, okay, that felt worth it, that felt good, because now we can at least get free priority. On a Heimer who already kind of naturally gets the priority with his towers, Again, I'm all eyes on Gadget. The team made a conscious effort to try to get him back into the game by feeding the gold or funneling resources into him, and I don't know if that's necessarily the right call with these different champions.
Yeah, again, if they continue to pay attention, I think Boss, who is ahead in this situation, also might wish that he had some support around him. We've seen that Xeros is capable of playing when he doesn't have support, and you know, still making sure he plays safe enough to not do too much silly stuff. We'll see if Boss is kind of afforded the same luxury, because again, imagine if the plates went over to him, maybe that Triforce is now done and you could start playing a little bit more aggressively. As it is, I think, with this Heimer being quite strong, playing for this next Drake might be fairly important and is going to be an Infernal as PVB already grabbed that first Cloud.
Yeah, and they're also moving in, making sure that they get control of the Scuttle. They want to have priority over into this mid lane. Maybe they hunt for a pick here, Pallet looking to go fishing.
Xeros does get some poke onto No Man's, but PVB gonna group and try and do some structure damage. Plates have dropped off, but still want to try and take the objective if you can.
They do need to be respectful though, because Big Koro, their big cannon right now, is still down into that bottom lane, so they don't want to force too heavy of a fight unless someone just really steps out of bounds, unless he's with the squad.
Right now, they're just happy to try and take a turret for himself and continue to extend that gold lead. 4 out of 6 kills do belong to Big Koro, and a bit of extra gold there coming from the turret as well.
Yeah, and he should be really close to his Rageblade now, so it feels like we should stall this Infernal if you're PVB until he has access to those two items, and then he's going to feel really comfortable walking into that scenario. Whereas for Vega Squadron, it's kind of the same thing if they want to contest for it, where you need to walk into the area early, clear out a lot of the vision, and then just start setting up your Heimer turrets. He's kind of like a champion like Gangplank, where, you know, when he's reacting to a fight, unless he hits his rockets, he's not going to bring much. If he gets there early and he has his setup, then he feels a lot more viable as a champion.
I mean, if you have the vision, Heimer plus Zoe seems like a pretty good area of influence to have when you're trying to take an objective, and Vega did actually take the time to push down the mid outer, so they still stay up in the lead as far as towers go. But with 10 seconds remaining on this Infernal, buys have come in. No major completed items just yet, at least not the raid play we might have expected, but certainly a fight will be had for this objective.
Yeah, which is why Gnarl's just trying to get priority. Maybe caught.
Shockwave onto Boss does a decent chunk of damage, but Gnarl will not have that cooldown now.
Yeah, that's massive, not having access to a big burst here. It feels like it'll change PVB's playstyle here, where they just run full steam ahead into this fight, versus this is really about trying to draw Vega Squadron out and threatening pressure on the mid tower, which is why you see them cutting upwards. Like, without Shockwave, we can't fight this unless it's perfect scenario.
Yeah, and you gotta go, because as you said, walking into a Heimer with no vision doesn't feel like a particularly fun scenario. So the Infernal Drake will go over to Vega. PVB will trade for the mid-outer turret. And gold is staying relatively close. Fengwu Buffalo up about 2,000 gold. Xeros will extend that lead as they actually take the turret lead for the first time this game as he finishes that off. And also, Boss, don't know what you're doing there, but that's an easy pickup.
Oh,
in fact, Santa's completed that, now forced to flash away. Xeros gonna come in and try and change the play. Olaf already popped the Ragnarok, but Xeros there with a flanking jet, an absolutely massive accelerated shock blast. Make sure Gadget's demise is felt. And now Ananasik knock back Big Koro, finds the ulti there in, and that's gonna be yet another kill. In fact, make it almost an ace. It's just Santas that survives.
And the devastating thing is that Vega Squadron had placed all of their vision to control the Infernal, but they didn't exit to the correct side, and they didn't have vision to spot out anywhere else that PVB were. Maybe they thought they went for a reset. Maybe they thought that they skirted up towards the top of the map, but Boss overextends, and the trigger is immediately pulled.
Again, your poke champion's far away in Fog of War, great. Your champion's next to a Nautilus with way more of the enemy team around than you, not a great idea. So watch this one again. I mean, Boss, just a greedy recall here.
Right on vision too. Yeah, you hate to see it, and then immediately the dog pile on top. Santas is trying to get in there, trying to save his top laner. Ultimately, it just baits out the rest of his team where they try to hang around, and Xeros doesn't hesitate. Immediately the teleport comes through, and he finds them on the back half with massive Jace damage.
Nice target selection as well. Knew they could try and chase for two targets and do so successfully. Fengwu Buffalo certainly have not lost their luster for blood throughout this tournament.
It's my favorite type of team. And watching Fengwu Buffalo, we were having this conversation earlier, Pacer Time. I was like, you know who they kind of remind me of? They kind of play a little bit like the Flash Wolves.
Yeah, Flash Cubs.
Yeah, where they unlock themselves really early from the lanes. They like to skirmish. It feels a lot like rotating priority around plates and rotating priority around Rift Herald, especially early on. And I kind of have a feeling that if you are Team Liquid versus Fengwu Buffalo and you are Vega Squadron versus Flash Wolves, that it makes sense that you would cross scrim. And so I assume that PVB probably scrimmed a lot with the Flash Wolves.
And again, if that team was good enough to pretty convincingly take down Vega, at least in this first game. Warning bells are starting to ring a little. Next Drake will be up in a few minutes. It will be Infernal number 2. Fungi Buffalo up about 5,000 gold, pretty substantial, as we're not quite at 19 minutes through this game. And again, Vega, despite all their creativity and the way they were able to pick up the pace throughout their playing group stage, they were not as good when behind. And I think the long game they eventually lost over to Mega is kind of a sign of a team that went ahead, they seem good. When behind, they can maybe struggle to find their way back into the game.
And the reality is like you were just saying, there was only one game where they really fell behind, so they didn't get a lot of immediate practice with it on this international stage. And specifically for this composition, it just hurts. Whenever assassins like, not assassins, well, no, I'll call Zoe an assassin. She's a mage, assassin, wave clear, priority, utility bot. She's fun. She's not fun, that was sarcasm. When you have someone like Zoe who doesn't have 100-0 kill pressure on something, she loses a lot of her valuability across the map, where she just becomes kind of a utility choke bot. And so maybe that's why they decided to prioritize Gadget, like getting access to gold so he can do really nice line damage with his rockets. Because think about this, if Nomans isn't able to kill anyone on PvP, which a lot of them have shields, a lot of them are naturally tanky, he's basically looking for Kai'Sa and hopefully that's it, then you need to have the follow-up damage from the Heimer, that if a Sleepy Trouble Bubble lands on someone, something has to nuke someone.
Well, looks like PvP are setting up for this next Drake, up in a minute 10 for the Infernal. And Vega Squadron, very bold farming in their own jungle here, to be honest. Probably gonna try and start the fight up again. It's Santa that's rooted there by the passive. Redemption goes down. Depth Charge is gonna be Stasis down. Boss there on the run with a good Vanguard Zed. Zeristo in a Rampage takes down another Sick. Nomans are able to get a trade kill, but Gnaw finds another as Gadget goes down. PvP blinking low, but not dead. They will get a trade, but a shutdown and an ace across the board for the Fongvu Buffalo.
Just absolutely obliterated right there. Big Koro with the confidence that he ults into the middle of all of that action happening right now. But three members still alive, the creep wave behind them and knocking on the base door.
Been happy to get a kill and take the Infernal in 30 seconds. They'll be even happier to take them this inhibitor at 21 minutes. In fact, Fongvu Buffalo might not be going too far after this. Looks like they will back off. Timers are still a little low. But all of a sudden, Vega's job was already very difficult. Now it's borderline impossible.
But you said it, you called it. You know, why are you farming in your jungle right now when you are so far behind? There is free access to gold across the map. You don't need to be in there. Now, they take the fight. You can look anywhere on your screen and kind of pick something cool that's happening. And by cool, I mean just a lot of explosions. Particularly the fact that Gadget really didn't have any impact on that team fight because he was immediately caught out by Gnaw's Orianna.
Yeah, he's got zoned by the Ori. And now Vega are doing the thing we just told them maybe not to do. But now they have a... No, they don't even have a man advantage. They're going to start this Infernal, though, and Fongvu Buffalo are going to make them pay. Zeros already with a massive Shock Blast. Gadget at 50% health. Shockwave finds two, and Anasik dead. Can't take the Drake now. Vega, what are you doing there?
Trying to fight from the back foot. You know, it's bold. That's all I got for it. It's bold.
I mean, maybe at this point you feel like the game is far enough out of reach that you have to do something desperate, but that seems reckless.
I think you're trying to drive tempo where you assume that maybe PvP have made a hard reset and you can take the dragon before they get back onto the map. You look at something like a Heimerdinger, it should be able to clean up dragons or monster objectives very quickly, and it's just kind of the wrong gamble. They did manage to disengage safely, although as I say that, that's a lot of damage. Ow.
Now, Zeris is quite the character. He's the kind of guy that, you know, if emotes were enabled, you'd see them all the time on top of this guy's head, I think. He just flashed, shock blasted over the wall, and then didn't even follow, just assumed Gadget would die from the poke. Gadget lives, so thankfully for him, now with his on his hourglass, might feel a little bit safer, but you can kind of tell the kind of swagger that Zeros is playing with right now. This team feels very comfortable.
And it's not just Zeros, it's also Big Koro. We talked about the last team fight. He immediately triggered the Kai'Sa ultimate to get into the thick of it. And it just feels like all of PvP really bounced back from their loss against TL yesterday. And whether that's, you know, hometown advantage, the fact that this is maybe a stylistic mismatch, a very fast team versus a very controlled kind of outthink team. But they're looking good today.
Certainly in this game, as they will pick up the Baron and move themselves ever closer to the 10,000 gold lead mark, up about 8 or 9k with a Magi's finish there by Gnaw. Looks like he needed some reading to do on the way back to the fountain.
The classic 23-minute Magi's.
We had a 10-sec Dark Silly's, like, I guess I'd do this. Let's see where they go next. Mid inhibitor will be back up in 2.5 minutes. That's actually quite a lot of time.
Boss.
Boss also realizes he's in the wrong neighborhood. Does get the stun down, but just you know, pressing his buttons, I think, at that point. As they'll take the blue buff away and look to try and start the push here on the bot lane, as Xerath's going to run down and escort those minions in with the Baron buff.
Yeah, it looks like we're pivoting between mid and bot lane, although that was a pretty healthy chunk taken out of Palette, so maybe hope still left there for the Vega Squadron.
Again, if you're going to get something done, you have to do it from a distance or find a pick-off if someone from the Fengwu Buffalo are too far forward. To their credit, they've played pretty disciplined, I have to think, this game. Been nice and well together, taking opportunities very swiftly. And again, if you want to compare this team favorably to the Flash Wolves, they're a team that, you know, pulls the trigger as soon as they see an opportunity, and I do see that kind of crispness in this first game for PVB.
It was one of the nice takeaways from yesterday's series between Vega and Flash Wolves, is that it felt like PVB have a bit of a Flash Wolves-like-esque style about them. Again, opening up maps, very skirmish heavy, rotating around and skirmishing over monster objectives.
All right, well, Vega will give up that inhibitor tower. I guess they don't feel like they can fight for this either, but at this point, you're running out of things to defend in your base. Don't think you want to make your last stand at the Nexus, but Fengwu Buffalo move in, take the inhibit in bot, and they're going to move out. Palette tagged, but he's fine.
I think an issue is you know, how do Vega Squadron even try to set up or prepare for a fight at this point? Yeah, you kind of are just watching your base get eaten alive right now. You're watching your house burn down, but you know, unless No Man's really tags significant damage onto a target, they don't have a lot of consistent hard engage. It's, you know, an Anisic, good luck. We will remember you fondly. Go in.
And then Santas usually follows and probably meets the same fate. I mean, they have cooldowns up. They can maybe try and look for a flank, but even those control wards moved up to support that seed from PVB. Just again shows this is a team that does their homework before they, you know, attempt anything too risky. Yes, they go at you quickly when they're trying to end the game or start an objective, but still make sure they do the little things first. And in this game, at least, it's merited them an absolutely massive lead.
I was curious what Little Gadget was up to right there. I feel
like some farm.
He was trying to. I actually think he was trying to assassinate Big Koro. He had Ananasic behind him. Speaking of that,
Boss is going to get 1v1 by Xerath's top lane matchup, which looked good when Boss was 2-0-1, is now certainly not that.
Is it a 1v1 or is it an assassination? I feel like.
I think if you have a Dustblade and you get a kill in a 1v1, I agree with you. It is an assassination.
I just feel like if you never get the opportunity to punch back, that's not a fight.
It's a stealth kill. All right, well, top tier 2 is dead. That's 8 turrets to 2. Mid inhibitors back up. That's about all the good news I have for Vega right now, unfortunately for them.
They're getting blitzed from all sides.
Meliodas popped his stopwatch. Probably didn't mean to do that, but all 3 inhibs are down. Baron is going to wear off. Beautifully timed.
Oh,
what
no.
A hook! Onto No Man. See you later. Big Koro going to grab himself a kill. No, he gets the inhib. That's Gnoll that picked up credit. Not sure it matters too much now, though. 5v4, everyone dying. That's a double kill for Gnoll. Big Koro picks up another. Onto Xerath, they will get the kill. There you go, just trying to collect what they can before they wrap up their keywords for game 2, because Gnoll going to grab the triple. That's going to be an ace in the base. Nexus turrets and the Nexus will fall down as the Fengwu Buffalo blitz through Vega in game number 1.
Felt like it was a fight fire with fire, everything. There was so much action across the map in the early game, but that just did not play into Vega's playstyle. I think you need to hit a hard reset, shake this one off and say, okay, let's try to slow down this game pace, because obviously going tit for tat against PVB, it's just them punching down. It wasn't even close.
If that was fire versus fire, Froskru, and that was a candle versus a flamethrower, did not feel close at all. Never bring a candle to a flamethrower fight.
Do you need help lighting this? That's basically what that was. Yes, can you please light my candle, please, sir?
I agree. I think don't play into the hands of Fengwu Buffalo. Your strength as Vega is, you know, playing unconventionally, playing through a more steady landing phase. That's the games we saw in that group. That was the identity in a lot of ways for Group B. I just feel like if you play the first 5 minutes again, things may look very different, because that was too fast from Vega.
Yeah, and unfortunately, it was, you had your pick. You didn't get the Karthus, but you did get the Heimerdinger, but it felt like there was a disconnect between Santas and Gadget. The fact that Santas goes in, ends up giving away kills, expending valuable summoner spells. So Gadget sitting there on the Heimer like, mate, what do you expect me to do? This isn't how the champion works right now.
All right, well, PVB have kicked off the series with quite the win. For more on how they did it, here's the State Farm Analyst Desk.
Thank you very much, Pastry Time. First win goes over to PVB in a smashing game 1 here against the Vega Squadron. Champion Select is where we're going to start, because, of course, as we were talking about these two squads, it was the more standard-oriented PVB that we think would adhere to the meta versus Vega. And how many tricks do they have up their sleeves when it comes to Champion Select? They did get the Heimer.
I mean, they pulled some tricks out. I didn't hate it. And we saw a lot of flex picks. You know, like Spawn and I were saying, the whole first half of the draft had three picks as well as two bands that were all flexes. So you can see the importance of them. It was just what they did with those flexes, I'm not quite sure was right.
Yeah, and I think that there were criticisms in my eyes of both drafts here. I didn't really see the place of the Olaf if this game slowed down at any point coming into a comp that has a Zoe as well as a Heimerdinger. That seems like a pretty difficult late game comp to navigate if you are playing Olaf. And then you could also maybe say Orianna as well if it didn't have such a brilliant laning phase. There were windows for Vega to win, but the game comes down to execution at the end of the day. And when you have a look at, you know, the first 5 minutes of this game, you can just see such glaring flaws in the way that the approach was there for the Vega Squadron lineup.
In particular, we got to look at the bot lane. We called out Gadget and Santos as possibly being a liability for this squad, and they were exactly that in this game. Credit to Big Coro and Pallet, though, for abusing that kind of disparity in the 2v2.
Yeah, Pallet was an absolute monster this game. It started off very early on. He made one mistake that ended up actually working in their favor. He took a hook in, you know, at a Heimer, like level one, and was like, oh, I lost all my health. And so then after that happened, though, the enemy team thinks, okay, we can kill him. And you heard Frost saying, this is not what Heimer does. If they had waited for one more level so you can actually combo with your Q better so you get more laser beams out, you can kill people. But once it starts going in their favor, Pallet's completely unlocked.
Yeah, and this is kind of where he becomes the jungler almost from the squad. Visits mid lane, gets summoner spells, goes top lane and protects Xeros while he's pushing out the map. The ability to translate a lead around Summoner's Rift is something that is quite difficult to do at times, and Pallet did it pre-level 6 as a support.
He's top lane at level 4. I love it. No wonder he picks up MasterCard Player of the Game for this one. You mentioned it, Mark. Maybe his highest deaths on his team, but that was because of the plays he was able to make across the map to help all three of his laners get ahead.
Right, and that's what's so impressive about it. It was all three lanes, that bot lane as well, going back down, finding more kills, and the reasons he was topside, it was like, this is a jungler's job. Your wave is pushing in, your top laner feels a little exposed. Your jungler should be up there protecting him. His jungler stealing the enemy team's blue buff, and he's topside.
And that's what I was going to say. This is Fongvu actually setting up multiple areas of the map at the same time. You would expect if he's coming off a reset and they are going for a blue invade that he's coming back bottom lane, that they're looking for that play. So, you know, maybe some potential review there for Vega to do. You know, if you don't have information, maybe search for it. But that's what they're doing. They're like looking at the vision game of Vega on the bottom side of the map. They're saying, this isn't good enough at the moment. We're going to look to abuse this. And kind of negating some of the strengths as well of the lineup. They had some slip-ups like Meliodas, like just charging in kind of at that first top lane gank was a little bit strange. So it's not like it was a flawless performance. Flash Shock Blast over the wall for kind of no reason, but still.
That
was a baffling.
Take it, like put it in the jar and never see that again.
But when it mattered, they played a control style to League of Legends.
Right, and all of those early kills across all three of the lanes also netted CS advantages for at least Null and Big Coro. Saros did, of course, fall victim to that early gank, which gave the Aurelia a bit of real estate to work with, but ultimately just that one lane wasn't enough for Vega Squadron to get anything done.
And before that gank was successfully completed from the Vega Squadron lineup, that was still a like positive 12 CS gap for the favor of the Jays, and it was quickly wrestled back as well. This is a Fongvu lineup that looked like they had control of all three lanes, and we're pushing forward on the map.
And I think one of the most evident things was that with that lead, or you know, that they had secured themselves there pre-20 minutes, they did exactly two
Vega.
That's
why he's the best flex pick, right there. 21,000 damage. That's why he's number one.
There you go. Point for Spawn on the flex pick tier list.
He had Aurelia higher than me too, though, and it got slammed by the Jace. So what? What's going on?
It's not a good matchup for Aurelia.
Hey, and how about that Nautilus, that mid lane Nautilus that can be flexed to support that neither of you decided to throw
jungle,
up on
apparently.
The list there.
Yeah.
He can jungle too now. Look at that.
That was like a multi-flex at the same time. I think, as we said, flex picks are super important.
Right.
And at the same time, you had Vega Squadron trying to do it a little on their own, but just not. The concern is like what you're getting with it. It didn't feel quite right. Like the Heimer lane could have worked if they played it a little slower, maybe. But then how does their comp all come together where you have a Zoe, which is picking, and a Aurelia that wants to go in, a Zoe or a Heimerdinger that's like a kind of an early pressured control champ.
See, I actually saw how it came together because I was thinking if they get ahead, face checking this comp with Heimer turret, Zoe bubbles, and the catch potential of the AoE taunt from Galio is incredibly potent. They have great setup around objectives and one of the strongest split pusher if you're able to accelerate the Aurelia. But then you look at the kind of checkbox that you have to go through and then you evaluate your opponent. Okay, so we have to be ahead of the team that has the best early game in the whole of the play-in stage that was willing to throw down with TL in that early game and looked impressive. I just think that they've gone towards the wrong kind of bucket when they're picking it. Pick some scaling, just like kind of let the game come to you at some point.
Well, right, yeah. You're like, we want to get ahead and have objective control, but you have two losing solo lanes, so it's like, it's going to be kind of hard. And then, yeah, the bot lane went south too, so it was a problem.
All right, well, things look good for PVB following game one. Vegas Squadron have selected Blue Side going into game two. We'll see if they can build a comeback.